Welcome to Algebra 2. We've got our final section of notes in this class, modeling with trigonometric functions. Now, if you think about how these functions have looked when we graphed them in the latter part of this chapter, what we found out is that, sine and cosine, those are values that rose and fell and rose and fell and rose and fell, and they had this repeating nature. You could say that they oscillate is a really good word to use. And that type of repetition happens all the time in the real world. You look at like daily temperatures. There's a high temperature and a low temperature for each day. And if you were to plot that out, every hour for a week or so, you would see a graph that looks very much, like a sine or a cosine function. Barring that you had any type of crazy hurricane or something like that happening, or a sudden blizzard that comes in, but it definitely shows that type of behavior. Sound waves are another really good illustration, or tides. We had a problem a while ago that dealt with the tides, where they're rising and falling, just like a sine or cosine graph. So what we want to do is, obviously, when we notice this type of pattern happening in the real world, we want to be able to graph, because graphs allow us to predict events that'll happen in the future. This is what meteorologists use to determine the likely high and low temperatures. Obviously, there are other, numbers that they take into consideration, but they also use this to predict what's going to happen in the future. So when you look at that 5-day forecast, they're kind of using a trig function to analyze what those temperatures are going to do. Same thing with tides. So we do have some new terminology, but a lot of it is tying into what we've already covered. So graphs that model sine and cosine functions, they have a name. They're called sinusoids. So a graph that shows that type of oscillating nature is called a sinusoidal graph. Okay, these are just manipulations of sine and cosine, and you can see we've got our standard type of equation that we used when we graphed these, when we used our rubber stamp method, or our cornerstone method, I think we called it too. All they've done is they've taken that b value that was determining how fast in the function, and they've just taken it out as a GCF. It's all still inside the sine or cosine function, but they've factored it out so that we can see the shifts a lot easier. All right, and then just again for reiteration, we haven't changed anything here. This is more of a reminder than anything else. The absolute value of A is the amplitude of the graph. 2 pi divided by B, since we're just dealing with sine and cosine, that's going to be the period of the graph. H is the phase shift. Since that B has been factored out, we can simply look at that set of parentheses and see the phase shift left or right immediately. And then y equals k is going to be the center line of that function. So if we're looking at a graph or at some data points, and we're trying to come up with a sinusoidal function that will represent this data, we just need to find the values of a, b, h, and k and plug them into the appropriate function. Now, some of this does kind of depend. Okay, how do I know whether to choose sine or cosine? And you could really get away with either one. And technically still be correct, but we have to have a little bit of knowledge. We talked about cosine being that water droplet graph. Just kind of knowing that cosine starts at a maximum, it has the potential to make our work a little bit easier when we're trying to decide, hey, what function am I going to use to model this data? We want to choose the one that's going to be easiest, and knowing what the graphs look like can be a real benefit to us. Okay, not only that, what if our data only kind of resembles a sinusoidal function? It's not, we're not given a perfect graph or perfect data points that do that. Well, just like we did linear regression and quadratic regression and exponential regression, we did all these different regressions. There is a sine regression as well that will output a sine function for any set of data points that we enter, a best fit sine graph. And just to refresh your memory on what the steps were to get to that menu, they are listed there in parentheses. We do have one last new word, one new bit of vocabulary, and that is the frequency of a sinusoidal graph. The frequency, you've probably heard that word before when we talk about sound waves especially. The frequency is simply the reciprocal of the period, and reciprocal, of course, just means 1 over. All right. So our first task is just to practice that new vocabulary. Frequency, find the frequency of the function. All right, well, let's take a look at number 4. the period of this function, it's a sine function, so I know its period starts off at 2 pi, and it's going 3 times as fast, so I divide out that 3 times as fast. That means that its frequency is the reciprocal, 3 over 2 pi. And I'm not entirely sure if the textbook wants you to use decimal answers for frequency or if it's okay leaving them exact. I like 3 over 2 pi, but let's do a decimal approximation just to be sure. 3 divided by 2 pi is 0.4775. All right, for the next one, we've got y equals cosine of pi x over 4. Well, that's really pi over 4 times x. They've just multiplied the x into the numerator. So the period of that graph is 2 pi divided by pi over 4, which is like 2 pi over 1 multiplied by the reciprocal of the denominator. That's just dividing a fraction. And we get the pi's to cancel. The period is just 8. Well, that means my frequency is going to be 1 over that 8, which is exactly equal to 0.125. Okay, and lastly, number 10, there's a lot of extra information here. Frequency of the graph, the amplitude has no bearing on the frequency, neither does a change in the center line if that graph has been shifted around at all. So this 0.2x, 0.2 is 1/5. I like fractions over decimals, and I only like to resort to decimals at the very end of a problem if necessary. So I'm going to think of that as 1/5 x, but you really could use a calculator from the onset here if you wanted to. So the period of this graph, it's a sine function, so it starts off as 2 pi, and I divide out that 1/5 as fast. Well, if I divide out 1/5, if I take a pizza and divide it into fifths, I'm making 5 pieces. So it's just like multiplying by 5 over 1. Multiplying by 5, I get 10 pi for the period. And that means the frequency of this graph is that 10 pi, but the reciprocal of it. And if I punch that into the calculator, I get 0.0318. So just a new vocabulary word. Obviously, I don't want to just give you a line that tells you what the word means. It's helpful to see it used in some context. So that's all that these problems are testing for us. A simple calculation. Example 2, write a function for the sinusoid. So here they've given us a graph, and they've outlined a couple points, a maximum point of 0.5 and a minimum point of pi over 4, negative 5. Okay, so the real question we need to ask is, do I want to develop a cosine model for this function or a sine model for this function? And the key is to look at what's happening when x equals 0. So when x equals 0, I notice that that graph is at a maximum point. So because it has a maximum here, it looks like when we start to trace it, we've got our water droplet graph. I think cosine is going to be an easier way to find the function that makes this curve. So I'm going to be building a y equals a times cosine of b times x minus h plus k. And you'll notice that instead of, I think we called them C and D when we were graphing them, they switched those to H and K, just like when we saw parabolas and some of our other figures that were being shifted around. We used H and K, and they're using that to bring in some familiar variables for us. All right, so let's figure out the A value. What is the amplitude of this graph? Well, it has a maximum height of 5. And a minimum of negative 5. If I average those two, take the mean value, I'll find the height that's perfectly in between them. And I get a height of, oh boy. Sorry, I'm finding the center line. If I find half of the distance between the two, okay, so 5 minus negative 5 Okay, that's the total distance between the two, the difference of those two heights. And I divide that by 2, I get 5. And clearly, you know, we can see if our maximum is positive 5, our minimum is negative 5, that means we are going 5 units away from the center line to begin with. We can use the graph to kind of confirm that. So 5 is my A value. All right, well, now let's see, looking at this graph, how long does it take to complete one cycle? Next, I want to find the B, the how fast is this going? Okay, the period of this function, it gets back to a maximum at pi over 2. Well, if its period is pi over 2, that equals 2 pi divided by whatever the B value is. So I get, in this case, a fraction equals fraction. I just need to solve for B. Let's cross multiply. B times pi equals 4 pi. If I divide pi from both sides, B equals 4. So this function's moving 4 times as fast. All right, now from a typical cosine function, has the graph been shifted to the left or to the right? And in this case, it has not, because its maximum is happening right there when x equals 0. If we had a maximum that was, say, like, 1 comma 5 or negative 1 comma 5, then we could use that maximum point to determine how far have we shifted from 0 producing a maximum to move left or right. So here our h value is 0 because there was no horizontal shift. So it's just an x minus 0, or we could just write just x inside. And then lastly, the center line, here's what I started doing from the onset. The center line is going to be what the average between our maximum and minimum produces. So I'm going to have the line y equals 5 plus negative 5 over 2. If I average that maximum and minimum height, I get a height of 0. Okay, so I essentially have a plus 0 for my k value. And my final function, I can just clean up this answer. It's 5 times the cosine of 4x. I don't know if anybody's learned about Bloom's taxonomy. That's where you are learning, if you're becoming a teacher, you learn what types of activities, what types of methods of delivery will cause the best learning and introduce critical thinking. And the very top of Bloom's taxonomy, the highest level of thinking you can do, is when you have to construct something. So that's what we're doing right here. A really, really nice way to bring all of this information about trigonometry together, have you construct something. And if you can do a problem like this, I know that you get it. Let's try another one. Okay, well, for this graph, it's definitely sinusoidal. They've given us a maximum and a minimum point yet again. And here I notice that at 0, the graph is neither at a maximum nor a minimum. It appears to be halfway in between. So when x equals 0, if I'm halfway in between that maximum and minimum value, I'm thinking that a sine function is a good one to try and fill in. I'm not seeing that water droplet start after when x equals 0. Instead, my cycle will have to oscillate all the way back to its center again. That's a good choice for sine. So here's what I'm trying to fill in. Let's see what we can figure out. All right, so I've got a maximum height of negative 1 up here and a minimum height of negative 3. So to find that amplitude, I'm going to take the difference between those two heights and divide it by 2. So if I have negative 1 and I subtract away negative 3, and divide by 2, find the difference and divide it by 2, I get positive 1. So that's my A value. Y equals 1 times the sine of. Okay, now let's look at the period of this graph. Well, to go from a maximum to a minimum and start repeating itself, I have to go from x equals 0 to x equals 3 halves. Okay, so that period is 3 halves. And again, that's equal to 2 pi divided by b. We get another cross multiplication problem. It says that 3 times b is equal to 4 pi. That means my b value is 4 pi divided by 3. Again, using the information from the graph and what we know about what the period of a function represents, we can use that. So sine of 4 pi over 3 times x. And again, sine is supposed to start with zero height and then either go up or down from there. So in this case, I have no horizontal shift because when x equals 0, that graph is at a height of 0. It's on its center line. So x minus 0. Now let's actually find that center line. Well, that's going to be y equals, what's the average of my maximum and minimum? I want to be right in between. That's where the center line is going to show up, and it sure looks like negative 2. So if I average those two, maximum and minimum heights, I do get a height of negative 2. That tells me k equals negative 2. And it sure does look like that sine graph has been shifted down 2 units. We have a lot of ways to confirm this. Let's clean up our answer. I get y equals sine of 4 pi over 3x minus 2. That's some powerful learning happening right there when you construct something like that. All right, for our next example, final example, here we're going to use the calculator to help us come up with a regression equation. And then we're going to interpret what the period of the graph will mean. Okay, so I'm going to bring up my calculator emulation program here, and we're just going to type in all of this data. And my t values go from 1 to 12, that's my input value. So when I go to the stat menu and I edit those stats, L1 is going to be all of my inputs. So I'm just going to enter 1, 2, 3, all the way up to 12. And then my second list will be all of the outputs. So 71, 73, 75, 78, 81, 85, 86, 85, 81, 76, 73. Ooh, and I missed one. I missed at 9, it was supposed to be 84. Again, we want to make sure that every input has an output that goes along with it. And there you can see I've correctly lined up all my outputs with their inputs. Okay, so now we're going to hit the stat key again. It saved all of that information that we've typed in. We're going to calculate, and we're going to scroll all the way down until we get to probably the bottom of our list. If you have a newer calculator than this 83 plus, you may have more options here, but we want to go to, on mine it's option C at the very bottom of the list, sine reg. So I'll hit enter, and then you may get a little like menu here where you have to hit enter to go all the way down to calculate. We'll hit enter, and there is our function. All right, now I'm going to just copy this screen really quickly. So that we can refer back to it, just so I don't have to keep going back and forth. But now let's write out this function and interpret what that means, what the period of this graph means. Okay, so my function coming out of the calculator is y equals 7.38 times the sine of 0.4975, call that 0.5. Oh, I'm sorry, that should be inside parentheses. Notice that they are putting that b value inside parentheses, a little different than what we did earlier this lesson. 0.5x minus 2.05. We'll go to two decimal places there. And then plus 78.64. So that's the function written out how we've seen it throughout this chapter. Now we want to interpret the period of the graph. Okay, I guess we technically this is not a correct answer. We want our function to be d as an output and t as an input. So depending on how strict your teacher is, we want to be sure that our input and output variables are correct. So we set it up this way. Now, what does the period of the graph mean? Well, the period of this graph, it's a sine function, so it's 2 pi divided by really close to 1 half. The period is 4 pi. So let's just envision what a typical sine function looks like. So you're rising, falling, and then rising again back to the center line. That's what one period does. So in this case, our period of 4 pi I apologize for our bells there. Our period is telling us how long it takes, right? It's an adjustment of our input. It's the period's telling us how fast, how long it takes for that graph to get back to zero. Okay, so in this case, the period is how long in months before the temperatures start to repeat themselves. All right, so in this case, once I've gone 4 pi months, I'll see the temperatures start to repeat themselves. And that makes sense. 4 pi, if you think about it, pi is approximately 3. 4 times pi is approximately 12. So that's saying after 12 months, we're going to start to see the same high temperatures that we saw 12 months ago. And you know, if you think about what the temperatures are like in July, well, fast forward 12 months, you're likely to see the same high temperatures again in July. So really makes sense that the how long question that's determining our inputs, in this case, is making the period of the graph, and it does fit in the context of our inputs being months. Around 12 months later, we're going to see the same high temperatures again. Very, very cool. All right, that does it for section 9.6, our final section here in Algebra 2. Here's your final textbook assignment. It's been a wonderful year, and I wish you the best of luck in honors pre-calc next year, or regular pre-calc next year, I should say.